nothing like the name of Jesus. There's nothing like the name of Jesus. There is no power greater. There is no issue greater. There is no sickness greater than the name of Jesus. We worship you, Lord. We thank you, Father. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Well, you can all be seated. Praise your name, Lord. Praise your holy name, Lord. Praise your holy name, Lord. Well, I have the privilege and the honor of sharing the message today, and it is truly a privilege and an honor. And Lord, I just pray in the name of Jesus that you would use me as a mouthpiece. That as I empty myself, Lord, you would fill me up with your spirit and you would pour it out onto every hearer today, online and in this room. I thank you, Lord, that we're going to see mighty things today. Miracles, signs, wonders and provision. We are going to witness it with our very eyes, Lord, because you are King, you are Lord, and you are surely in this place. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, everyone good?
Amen.
Good. Praise the Lord. So the church is a sleeping giant with identity as its security, the Holy Ghost as its power source, and love as its secret weapon. Do you want me to say that again? It took me a while. It's like, oh Lord, that's a good one. The church is a sleeping giant with identity as its security, the Holy Ghost as its power source, and love as a secret weapon. So it's time to wake up the giant in you. And today's the day. Today's the day. Hallelujah. So I want to speak about identity. Identity is your security. Knowing your identity in Christ is security. It's security. And I pictured it like this. It's like a security guard standing at the door of your life. And, you know, the devil comes and he tries to lie to you about something. But if you know your identity, what happens? You can stand there and go, nah, sorry, not letting you in. Yeah. Knowing your identity causes you to be more powerful than the lie that's trying to get into your life. So for many years, I didn't know my identity. I grew up very, not in the best kind of mindset. I was very depressed, even from a young age. And I believed all the lies and I was, you know, quite outcast and put down. So my circumstances growing up formed my identity. And I know there's many of you in here today that actually have that identity of your past. That you still think the way that you were when you were younger. What people said, how you were treated, that's formed your identity. But now that you're a Christian, that all changes. Hallelujah. Praise God for that. That all changes. It took me a little while to understand this, but as I did, oh man, oh wow, my eyes started to open up and God started to do things in my life and I thought, oh my goodness, this is so good. I don't have to believe that anymore. That's not who I am. The very fact that I stand before you today and I'm speaking to you is an absolute miracle. It's a miracle. My greatest fear in life wasn't heights, wasn't spiders, wasn't anything. It was speaking in public.
Come on.
Come on. Come on. today because I'm up here. Hallelujah. Oh, because that's who I am now. I'm not that timid person who's so afraid that I'm going to say something wrong and someone's going to judge me. No, I am a new creation. I have been created in Christ. And I'm not who I was once any longer. I have the greatest power living in me, the Holy Spirit, who empowers me to do what I do. I can't do this without Him. But knowing your identity is power. It's the greatest power that you can possess because as it's your security. You will stop every lie of the enemy from trying to enter in. Now, I tell you, he did try this week to, you know, knock at my door, but I sent him flying. I said, nah, I'm a new creation. That's not me anymore. And guess what? I've got more power than you, so get behind me. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So let's have a look at 1 John 3:1. To see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. You are a child of God. You need to understand that. You are a child of God. You are in His family. You belong to Him. You don't belong to the world any longer. Amen? And let's go to 2 Corinthians 5:17. It says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun, and all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to Himself through Christ, and God has given us this task of reconciling people to Him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to Himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And He gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making His appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin so that we could be made right with God through Christ. You are no longer who you were. You need to know that today. You are a new creation. You are a child of God. And Jesus didn't die so you could just get to heaven. Okay? This is part of your identity. He didn't die so you could just get to heaven. He died so heaven could get into you. Amen? He died so heaven could get into you and you could release it onto the earth. That's who you are. That is who you are. Each one of you. Doesn't matter what your calling is. You are called to bring heaven to earth. Amen? Amen. He bridged the gap between you and your Heavenly Father once again so that you could have an intimate relationship with Him. And it's through that intimate relationship with Him that we bring heaven to earth. We don't just bring heaven into us and keep it. We bring heaven onto everybody that we are surrounded by. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So your identity is this. You are a child of God, saved by grace, and not by your own works, but by Jesus' finished work on the cross. Because of this salvation, you are no longer who you used to be. You are loved by your Heavenly Father. You are a carrier of His glory. You are now an ambassador of Christ. You carry the name of Christ. You carry the same power He carried, and you are the source for other people's salvation and freedom. Amen? You are the source for other people's salvation and freedom. Hallelujah. You were not saved to just attend church and build your own life. You are not. You are not. If you are right now stuck in a rut of just attending church, going and living your life, I want you to awaken this morning. I want you to awaken. That is not what you were called to do. You were called to be saved, receive, and give. Okay? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I praise you. So the next part of this message is the Holy Spirit is your power source. So let's talk about the Holy Spirit. I love the Holy Spirit. Oh, I love him. I love him so much. I can't do life without him. He is everything. He brings security to us. He helps us. He strengthens us. He reveals hidden things. He helps me parent my children. I can't do it without him. You know, so many people would say to me when my children were younger, how do you do it with five kids? And it was a great way to share Jesus because I actually can't do it without him. I can't. I don't know everything. I don't know how to do life. You know what, guys? I didn't even finish school. I'm going to say it. I didn't finish year 12. I was a dropout. I was depressed. I was, you know, life was terrible for me in those years. And so, you know, gaining my identity and learning who the Holy Spirit is has been the greatest thing in my life. The greatest thing, because it's given me power that I never thought I had. It's helped me to show others the way. So we need to know who he is. The Holy Spirit is your power source, and you cannot accomplish all that God has called you to do without having a relationship with the Holy Spirit. As we commune with him, learn his ways, listen to his voice. That's very important. Listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit. We will bear the fruit of the Spirit, receive his gifts, and grow in our identity and our love walk. We cannot grow in our identity and our love walk without the Holy Spirit. We can't. Because he's our helper. Amen? So I was thinking about the disciples and how they were in the upper room just before they received the Holy Spirit in great power. And I realized that, you know what? They gave time. They gave time to be together in prayer. They gave time to seek God for the next journey that they were going on. Because Jesus said to them, wait in Jerusalem. Wait. Wait. And it's like Pastor Melena was sharing today. Rest. Wait. Wait. Rest in him. Wait on him. If there are things that are going on in your life that you don't have answers for, then I urge you, stop. And wait on him. Get your Bible. Put on some worship. Worship him. Read the word. And say, Holy Spirit, show me. Show me the next step. What do I need to do? What step do I need to take? How am I going to do this? How am I going to get out of this issue that I'm in? Where am I going? If you guys are looking for homes, where do you want me to live? What do you want me to buy? You have to wait. Relationship takes time. We can't just rush from A to B and constantly be distracted by the things of this world. Because unfortunately, the lures and things of this world are such a time robber. They rob our time with God. And I know that, you know, many of us have phones, and we get distracted by them. Amen? Yeah, I am going to preach it. Yeah, because you know what? That little device can steal so much of your intimacy with God. I got set free of that. I actually did. You know, the Lord showed me something a number of months ago. He was showing me how Peter, he was ministering to people, and they all wanted to get near Peter because they knew he had an anointing. And so What happened was, the word was around that Peter was going to be in this location, so they all went just to be in his shadow. They believed that even the shadow of Peter would heal them. That's powerful. It was their faith. They believed. So the anointing that was on Peter, even the surroundings caused healing, deliverance, miracles. He didn't have to touch them. Don't you want to be like that? Come on! Don't you want to be able to walk into a room where your very presence changes the atmosphere? You know, I want to go, well, I'm having people over at my house for Christmas, so I'm not going anywhere, but I want my very presence to touch my unsaved family. I want the anointing that's on my life to ooze onto them. To the point where they'll go, there's something different. And they get curious. Because oftentimes when we try to share Jesus with our family, they don't listen too much. You know? because they know us and they think, oh, no, you're still that person. No, I'm not. I'm a new creation. But, so, you know, we've got to, we want to get to that place where that anointing is so strong on us that our love oozes, that his spirit oozes, that it's not us anymore. And the way that that happens is through your intimacy with the Holy Spirit. It's intimacy with him. When you need intimacy, you shut the door and you put away all distractions. The phone, the people, and you sit there with the Holy Spirit and you say, Lord, speak to me. Speak to me. This is the most powerful place that we have as Christians, is our time with him. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And it's in that intimate place that we receive power. Because the disciples, like I was saying before, the disciples were gathered together and they were praying, waiting. They obeyed what Jesus said to do. They obeyed. They waited and they prayed. And as they obeyed the word of the Lord and stood united, they got ignited. They got ignited. They got ignited with the Holy Spirit. It says in Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. As they waited, as they communed with him, power came. To do what? To be his witnesses. Not to keep it to yourself. Not to be selfish with it. But to go and preach the gospel. To lay hands on the sick. To cast out demons. To raise the dead. To bring heaven down to the earth. Amen. That's part of your identity. That's who you are. You have power living inside of you. A great power. I'm going to share a testimony. This happened many, many years ago, but it's honestly one of the greatest testimonies that I can share of being filled with the Spirit. Now, I was driving home. My eldest two daughters were quite young. And I was driving home and I was almost there and I was stuck at the traffic lights and I saw this vision, this open vision came before my eyes. It never happened to me before. And I'm seeing my husband in a coffin. And I was like, what was that? Shocked me. And immediately I remembered Psalm 91. Because, you know, I go to church every Sunday, and Pastor Gary, who is such an amazing preacher, he fills us with the word, and so I took it. And I went, no, Psalm 91, and I had remembered a few lines of it, not the whole thing. And so I just started declaring that, but I didn't know what else to pray. But there was this urgency inside of me to pray for my husband. I didn't know what was happening. And so I began praying in the Spirit. The Holy Spirit prayed through me to bring breakthrough for him. So I tried to call him. He didn't answer, which, you know, stressed me a little bit because I didn't know what was going on. And he came home that night, and I said to him, so how was your day? He goes, oh, you don't want to know. I said, no, I actually do. I said, because I know something happened to you today. Are you okay? He said, I am okay by God's grace. So he was at work. He's in the building industry, and he was using an angle grinder. And back then, they were all corded. There was no cordless angle grinders back then. And so we're going back sometime. And he was grinding something, and it flipped back and attached to his shirt. And it wound his shirt round and round and round, started slicing into him just above his heart. At that very moment that that was happening, I had the vision. And I began declaring Psalm 91. And I began praying in the Spirit. He said to me that day, he said, it felt like someone was pushing it into my chest. He said, but somehow I managed to get that unplugged and it stopped. There was blood everywhere. He was cut, like he was sliced. And I just looked at him and I said, the Lord saved your life today. And it was through the gift of the Holy Spirit that I'm thankful that my husband is still alive today. Because no matter what the enemy wants to throw at you, come on, you have a power in you that is greater than anything on this earth, greater than any spiritual power, greater than any demon. And if you choose to use it, you will overcome. You will overcome. You will. I have another testimony. Do you guys like testimonies?
Yes.
You okay? Is this okay? I'm feeling a little relaxed now. So I have another testimony, and this was of my second daughter. She's a fireball. She still is. And she would always run off. She'd never stay with us. So we'd always have to run after her and keep close watch. Nothing's changed. Love you, Bob. She's here. And so she was about almost 2 years old, and we were in Melbourne. I was very pregnant with my son, and so we were with some family. So Rudy, my husband, stayed with Liana and my aunt down at the river, which we were having a picnic at, and I took the other girls up to the bathroom. And as I'm walking back from the bathroom, again, I see a vision. I see a vision of Liana falling in the water. And without hesitation, I started praying in the Spirit. Probably for a good 3 minutes, just praying in the Spirit. Would not stop. Something was happening. You could feel the atmosphere shift. And I thought, oh gosh, what's happening to her? Anyway, so I trusted in God. We walked back. And my husband was as white as a ghost. I said, did she almost fall in that water? He said, how do you know that? I said, I saw it and I started praying. He said, well, you saved a life. He said, because I literally caught her by the tag on the back of her shirt. It was a murky, yucky river. And if she fell in there, she can't swim, can't find her, you can't see where she's gone. God saved her life. See, the devil tries. The devil tries, but he can't win. He can't win. If we're alert, we know who we are, and we use the power that he's given us, he can't win. He cannot, and he will not. Hallelujah. So Thank you, Lord. He's so good.
Yes, he is.
He's so good.
Yes, he is.
I thank you, Father. I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you're our ever-present help in times of need. You're always there. You're always with us. Thank you, Father. And, you know, for quite some time before that season, I was having a lot of dreams about my daughter falling into murky water. It was dream after dream after dream, and I was distressed. I was like, what is happening? What's going to happen to my child? What is going on? And the Lord taught me through that season to go into warfare. And the way you do that is you ask the Holy Spirit for a scripture. Say, Lord, give me a scripture. Give me a word. Because it's His word that's powerful, not mine. Not yours. It's His word. But as we speak His word, the angels go to work for us. Amen? Because we've all got angels that assist us. And so I would declare no weapon. No weapon that is formed against my child will prosper. No weapon that is formed against my family will prosper. And any tongue that rises up in judgment against us, I shall condemn. So I tear down every tongue that's risen up against my family. And you know what? The weapon was formed. She did almost fall in. It's not that it wasn't formed. It was.
Yeah.
But God.
Yeah.
God intervened. God intervened through His power in me. Are you seeing the picture now? Do you see how He works through you? Yeah. Amen. So don't discount when you see things, hear things, because the Lord will use that. You ask Him for clarity. Ask Him for clarity of what's going on, and He will lead you.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. So love. We're in the love revolution.
Yes.
Praise God for the love revolution. Love is your secret weapon. It's not a weapon that you can hold, but it's a weapon that you can give. You can show. You can touch. Love is an action, and it will disarm any person or situation. Love changes the atmosphere and melts and softens hard hearts. When we can show the love of Christ to others, it disarms them. And it causes hard hearts to melt. So let's look at what love looks like. 1 Corinthians 13:4. It's our key scripture for this year. And you know, when Pastor Gary started sharing this scripture, I was looking at all those words going, oh, I've got to work on some of that. Did anyone else have that happen? This should be before our eyes regularly. And we should be testing our love walk regularly so that we can be a better witness to those who are around us. It says, love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Lord, love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless, but love will last forever.
Amen.
Love will last forever. It's eternal. Because God is love, and He is eternal.
Amen.
Amen. But it's really hard to love others when you don't love yourself. And that's where the importance of knowing your identity comes. I didn't love myself. I didn't, because I believed everything everyone told me when I was growing up. And I was so overcritical of myself. The way I sounded, how I looked. You can imagine it, I criticized myself. It was just, you know. And it caused me to be so bitter to myself that I couldn't give the love that God wanted me to give to others. Because the way you see yourself, you'll end up seeing others. You know how Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself? How do you love them as yourself the way that God wants you to love them if you don't have God's love in you? If you don't understand how much God loves you, how are you going to pour that out into others? So it's very important that we learn to know the love of God for us and how dearly He loves us regardless of where we've been, what we've done. When we come to Him in repentance, we receive His love. And it's then that we can pour it out. Because I can't give what I don't have. So if you're struggling in your love walk, I encourage you to come to the altar today and give that to the Lord. Give it to the Lord. Tell Him the things that you don't like about yourself and ask Him to heal that. Because He doesn't see you the way you see yourself. He doesn't. You know, if I've ever had issues with somebody, which we all do, I will always ask the Lord, Lord, help me to see them through your eyes. Because my eyes are flawed. My eyes are flawed. If I don't see these people through your eyes, then I'm going to see them through my flesh, and that's bad. Because that's not God's love. When we see people through our own eyes, that's not God's love. It's your own perspective. But we have to see them through His perspective. Amen? So as you receive, you can then give. But you have to be open. There are areas of your life that you will need to open up. There are old wounds that you will need to expose so that He can come and pour His beautiful medicine onto it and heal your wounds. And as you do that, you can then go and be a good witness. Amen? Hallelujah. Can I have a drink? Thank you, Jesus. Now, I want to come to my last point, and it's very important. Very, very important. It's the Word. The Word. You cannot know or have any of what I've just spoken about without this. Because this is where the authority is. This is where the power is. I'm going to tell you a story from the Old Testament. So it's in 2 Kings 22, but we won't go to the scripture just yet. I'll give you a little bit of a background story on the scripture that I'm about to read. So King Josiah was 8 years old when he became king. The kings before him were evil, wicked. They did not honor the Lord in any way, shape, or form. They actually brought a big curse onto the nation. But King Josiah was different. He had a heart for God, and he wanted to please Him. And in that season, I think he was about 18 years later, after he was crowned, he started to restore the temple. He asked for the people in the nation to come and help restore the temple of God. That's actually quite significant. And so as they were restoring the temple of God, the workers found a scroll. And it was the book of the law, the blessing and the curses. And so let's go to 2 Kings 22:8, and this is where we find ourselves in the story. Hilkiah, the high priest, said to Shaphan, the court secretary, "I have found the book of the law in the Lord's temple." I have a question, though, before I continue. Why was the book of the law hidden? Why wasn't it in plain sight in the temple? Then Hilkiah gave the scroll to Shaphan and he read it. Shaphan went to the king and reported, "Your officials have turned over the money collected at the temple of the Lord to the workers and supervisors of the temple." Shaphan also told the king, "Hilkiah, the priest, has given me a scroll." So Shaphan read it to the king. When the king heard what was written in the book of the law, he tore his clothes in despair. When he heard it, he tore his clothes in despair. Then he gave these orders to Hilkiah the priest. Now, this is going to be challenging. Some of the names are interesting. So give me grace. Ahikam, son of Shaphan, Akbor, son of Micaiah, Shaphan the court secretary, and Asaiah the king's personal advisor. Go to the temple and speak to the Lord for me and for the people and for all Judah. Inquire about the words written in this scroll that has been found. For the Lord's great anger is burning against us because our ancestors have not obeyed the words in this scroll. We have not been doing everything it says we must do.
Wow.
They realized that the reason why there was so much bad stuff going on in the nation was because they were not looking at this and using the instruction that was given to them. Now, we can relate that to ourselves today. We can be going through troubles, we can be going through hard times, yet this is usually on the side and everything else is right in front of us. So, the Bible is here, it's within reach, but everything else is before me. As I face life, this must be here. And everywhere I go, and everywhere I walk, this must be before me. This must be on my heart. This must be on my lips. Because without this, I have no power. I have no instruction. I have no peace, and I have no help. I can recall many, many situations where I have been in distress and I don't know what to do. And I will say, "Lord, give me a word. Give me a word." Because do you know what that word does? In the storm, it sets an anchor. It sets an anchor. And that boat is not going to go here and there and over there and drift away. It's going to stay firm because the storms come. They come. It's inevitable. But this will keep me on a solid foundation. It will keep me from being unmoved. It will keep my eyes fixed on him and it'll keep peace. Peace. The Prince of Peace. Oh, it'll keep peace in the midst of it all. That's why the word is so important. You cannot know your identity. You cannot have power that the Holy Spirit can work through if you don't meditate on the word day and night. Day and night. And look, guys, this doesn't mean you're going to sit there and go, "Okay, now I've got to read a whole chapter today." You know, no. Lord, I want to know you. You know, years ago, I struggled to read the the books in the Old Testament, like Numbers and Leviticus, and, you know, because I'm a spirit girl. Like, I want power. I want fun. I want miracles. I want to see, you know, the power of God just do stuff. And I don't want to read about genealogy. I can't even say it. Genealogy and lineage and the Lord rebuked me. He did. And he said something so tender. He said, how are you going to know all of me if you don't read all of it? How are you going to know all of me if you don't read all of it? It's not boring. When we say, Lord, show me. So that's what I did. I said, okay, Lord, where do you want me to start? He said, Leviticus. And I went, oh, no. Oh, gosh. And so I started reading Leviticus. And yeah, that's why I just, I talk a lot to Milena about those things. She can tell me. No, the Lord needs to tell me. But so I started reading Leviticus with that kind of attitude where I was like, okay, Lord, every word that is written here is for me. Every word is valuable. Just because I think it's not, that's not true. Because if God didn't want it in here, it wouldn't be in here. So we've got to read it all. So I started reading Leviticus, and my gosh, I got the greatest revelation. The greatest revelation from all this killing animals and sacrifice and this and that. And this isn't in my message. I'm just going to share it. But constantly throughout that book, it says that, you know, and you have to put all the fat on the altar. Like, pretend that's the altar. You cut the animal, and there's certain bits and pieces that you need to put on the altar through every animal. But through every sacrifice, all the fat had to go on the altar. I was like, Lord, what's with the fat? What is with the fat? Why the fat? He said the fat is the oil that keeps the fire burning. You get that? When you sacrifice things in your life, it produces oil and it keeps the fire burning in you. It keeps the fire burning in you. I want to be lit aflame for God. I don't want the distractions of this world to pull me back and cause the anointing to diminish. Because that's what distractions do. So I got set free from social media. Hallelujah. It was taking too much of my time. And this was lacking. And that's not good, because you have a calling. Each one of you has a calling. You are not just called to come to church and live your life. You're not. Come on. You are called to bring heaven to earth. You are saved so that you can bring others to salvation. My mother-in-law's here today. And I love my mother-in-law. She says, oh, wow. She's the reason why I'm here. She is. She was praying for her son, my husband, for years, for his wife. She called me by name. It was on her heart to call me in by name. She would say, I want a... what the English name? A daughter-in-law. Sorry, when we talk Armenian to each other. Yeah. sorry, guys. So she said, I want a daughter-in-law that's named Bianca, whose parents come from this region of Turkey. I'm Armenian, but my parents were born in Turkey. And she would pray that continually. Continually, the Holy Spirit put it on her heart. Why? Because I didn't have anyone else praying for me. And her prayers pulled me out of the pit of hell and placed me in the the kingdom of God. She was led by the Spirit of God to pray for me by name. Little did she know that I was caught up so far in the world that I didn't want to live. I was so depressed and anxious that I couldn't think straight. I couldn't finish school. She didn't know that. But she obeyed God to pray that, and I'm here today. I wonder how many of you God has spoken to, but because you've been so distracted, you haven't heard him. You haven't obeyed. So I'm going to finish with this. So Josiah obeyed the word. Do you know what he did? He went through that entire nation and he tore down every Asherah pole, every form of pagan worship, every temple, every altar that was a desecration to God. Not only that, he went and killed every priest that would worship Baal and all these ungodly priests. He actually went and killed them. And anyone else who worshipped those gods, he slaughtered. He slaughtered them. And this is very significant for today, because some of you need to put to death some of the things that are getting in the way of God and what you're called to do. Today's the day. The giant in you needs to come awake. The giant in you, the Holy Ghost, Spirit-filled, Jesus-loving giant in you needs to come awake. You can no longer go through this life coming to church every Sunday, going and living your own life. Hallelujah, I'm saved. I'll, you know, just be fine. No. Her prayers got me here. Who prayed for you? Who prayed for you? Who called you into the kingdom of God? Who was brave enough to invite you to church? Who was brave enough to open their mouth and speak the gospel to you? Who? You need to go and thank them today. And then you need to say, Lord, use me like you use them. And if there is fear stopping you, I want you to bring it to the altar today. Because the fear of man does not belong to us. I was set free of this. And I cannot tell you how good it feels to not care what other people think when it comes to doing the things of God. I cannot tell you how freeing it is to be able to stand up here and share the gospel with you and empower you to go. Today. The first is that if you struggle in your identity, I want you to come to the front. Come forward. If you struggle with your love walk and being loved by God and accepting His love, I want you to come to the front. If you're not filled with the Holy Spirit or you feel like it's dried up in you, I want you to come to the front. Hallelujah. And for those of you who know that there's something greater in you, there's something greater in you, but you just don't know what it is, I want you to come to the front. Because we're going to lay hands on you this morning, and we're going to release the power of God. And if there's anyone who is sick, has pain in their bodies, I want you to come to the front. Because I know that the Lord is going to demonstrate His love this morning. He's going to show you the power that is in these people. He's going to show you that He can work through you to go and heal others. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Just worship Him for a minute.
Like the wind, fickle. Holy Spirit, come, burn like a fire, blow.
Oh. Okay, pastors, you can begin praying. Thank you, Jesus. I speak freedom over every single person in this room today, Lord. I speak a newfound identity in Christ. Holy Spirit, baptize afresh your people. Baptize afresh your people today. Oh, and Lord, the love of the Father to rest upon each and every single one, Lord. Your love to rest upon each and every single one today. Hallelujah. Go right ahead.
Holy Spirit, come and burn like a fire. There's none like you.